Tonight, flood emergency in California. The entire state on high alert as heavy rain drenches the region. Torrential downpours triggering landslides and mudslides. Destructive winds knocking down palm trees in Santa Barbara. Water rescues underway as flash flooding sends cars floating down roadways. Dangerous travel in higher elevations as feet of snow blankets the area. The concerns for more flooding and the risk for tornadoes as this atmospheric river slams the Golden State. Also tonight, outrage over Navalny. The wife of Russian opposition leader Alexei Navalny vowing to carry out his work while accusing Putin of a cover-up. Hundreds of supporters arrested as they pay tribute to the opposition leader. Navalny's death prompting political fallout here in the U.S. What Trump did and did not say in his first public remarks on Navalny, sparking outrage from his rivals. New Israeli strikes in Lebanon. IDF fighter jets targeting alleged Hezbollah storage facilities in a fiery attack. Officials in Lebanon calling on the international community to step in before a wider regional war breaks out. What Israel claims provoked those airstrikes. In Mexico, tens of thousands taking to the streets in a March for Democracy rally. Massive crowds pushing back against proposed changes ahead of June's presidential elections. Their demands as they accuse the current president of trying to weaken the electoral authority. Plus, an American woman missing in Spain, her friends desperate for answers after she vanished under mysterious circumstances. Officials in the U.S. and Madrid launching investigations on both sides of the Atlantic. The troubling moments leading up to her disappearance. And a Florida deputy jumping into action after a deadly crash. The officer bringing a six-month-old back to life after pulling her from the wreckage. That child's mother praising his quick thinking as the reason her baby is still alive. Top Story starts right now. Good evening. I'm Ellison Barber in for Tom Llamas. Tonight, nearly the entire California population under flood alerts as another powerful atmospheric river slams the state. Rounds of rain drenching the already saturated region, triggering mudslides and landslides. Los Angeles taking no chances after a series of recent storms. One area tarping up a hill to try and prevent damaging runoff. Intense flash flooding cutting off this road in Montecito. The super soaker already pushing rivers to the brink. And the system isn't just packing torrential rains, but also destructive winds. Strong gusts taking down several palm trees along the coast. In the higher elevations, it's not inches, but feet of heavy, wet snow falling, leading to treacherous travel. Officials urging drivers there to stay off the roads. This slow-moving storm also packing the threat for hail and even tornadoes. Bill Cairns is standing by to time it all out. But first, we want to get to NBC's Liz Kreutz, who starts off our coverage tonight in Ventura, California.
Tonight, another powerful storm pummeling California. Whoa. Up and down the coast, 35 million people under flood watches. The deluge leading to dangerous driving conditions, spinouts, and overturned cars. At least four mudslides reported in Los Angeles. While near Sacramento, drivers like this man getting stuck, thinking he could get through this rushing water. Similar rescues near Santa Barbara.
During these storms, people often seem to underestimate the power of water.
They absolutely do. Water can kill. And so be very, very cognizant of rushing water, especially in vehicles.
The airport there once again canceling all flights, leaving travelers scrambling.
They said the airport is closed for the day. It's flooding.
In Ventura County, portions of Highway 101 also flooded. Traffic backed up on the major interstate as crews worked to pump water off the roadway. And just north, much of Refugio State Park underwater and now closed to the public after these once majestic palm trees came crashing down.
There are several of these massive trees here that have been completely uprooted, collapsed into the ocean, and with the soil even more saturated, officials say these trees they've marked in blue could also go down at any time.
This all comes after the deadly atmospheric rivers that pounded California 2 weeks ago. The series of back-to-back storms taking a toll on the state's infrastructure. Overnight, heavy rain causing this mudslide in Northern California, fallen trees blocking the road below. This relentless rain leaving behind yet another mess in this already saturated state.
And Liz Kreutz joins us now. Liz, what are the conditions like where you are at this moment?
Well, Ellison, some good news here. It does seem like the conditions are improving. It just stopped raining here, but showers are expected on and off through tomorrow, and we are still very much feeling the impacts from this storm, from those mudslides to the high surf advisory here on the coast. Millions of people also remain under those flood watches. And Ellison, in Central California, there's even a possibility for a tornado later tonight. Ellison.
Liz Kreutz in California. Thank you. For more on this wet winter weather, let's get right to NBC News meteorologist Bill Cairns, who joins me now in studio. Bill, what is the latest on the track out west?
Yeah, this morning was the heavy rain, the flooding, the mudslides, the landslides, all the pictures you just saw. Now we're focusing in on, are we going to get severe weather with this? Going into today, we knew there was at least an isolated shot of getting thunderstorms in the Central Valley here, especially from Chico all the way to Yuba City to Sacramento, where we could get small supercell thunderstorms. Supercell thunderstorms are the ones that produce a lot of hail and sometimes tornadoes. So that was the concern. And just in the last half hour, we now have our first tornado warning that has been issued in California this afternoon. So here's Chico. They're under severe thunderstorm warning. This has now moved north of the city there. No tornado spotted with that one or radar indicated. But jumping out of Oroville, we got another strong thunderstorm. You see the lightning strikes here in this little magenta. This is a tornado warning. Again, it's heading up into the higher terrain areas in Belden. You're going to be told to probably seek shelter as this heads your way here shortly. This is radar indicated. But again, just a sign that the atmosphere is primed for at least a few strong thunderstorms. This will not be widespread or a tornado outbreak, but just one or two tornadoes obviously can cause significant damage. Then this slow-moving storm is going to linger, and that's why the flood alerts are still up. We have a little break now, but Southern California, more additional rains coming in tomorrow, especially during the daylight hours. Another 1 to 3 inches. The mountainous areas could get maybe 3 to 5 inches of rain. And then, of course, Northern California, we're not done with you yet. You still are going to get additional rain. And how much rain has fallen in Los Angeles this February? We're almost up to a foot. The record for the most rain ever in a February was 13.68 inches. We still got 10 days to go, Ellison. We may break this all-time February record by the end of tomorrow.
Wow. Bill Cairns, thank you. We appreciate it. Turning now to our other major headline tonight, the international firestorm over the death of Russian opposition leader Alexei Navalny. The wife of the prominent Putin critic now speaking out, accusing the Russian president of having her husband fatally poisoned and now working to cover it up. NBC News chief international correspondent Keir Simmons is following it all.
Around the world, outrage growing over the death of Vladimir Putin's most outspoken critic, Alexei Navalny, just days after the 47-year-old died while imprisoned in one of Russia's Arctic penal colonies. His wife, Yulia, defiant, speaking out in a video message posted to his YouTube channel, vowing to continue his work and alleging Russian officials are refusing to hand over his body to hide a poisoning using the nerve agent Novichok. Vladimir Putin killed my husband, she says. We know why exactly. We'll tell you about it soon. The head of Navalny's Russian anti-corruption fund says investigators told him Navalny's body won't be shown to his mother for 2 weeks because an investigation is underway. Meanwhile, across Russia, authorities cracking down on those expressing support for Navalny. OVD Info, a watchdog group which tracks political arrests, reports nearly 400 people were arrested over the weekend. But despite the risk of detainment, many still laying flowers at growing memorials for Navalny in cities like Moscow and St. Petersburg. This Moscow resident saying she felt it was her duty to bring flowers. Navalny fought for all of us, she says. We have to at least honor his memory. No cause of death has been released. In a phone call with reporters, Kremlin spokesman Dmitry Peskov said all appropriate actions are being taken and called the West's reaction to Navalny's death absolutely unacceptable. Putin himself has not yet made a comment, but I sat down with Russia's leader in 2021 and pressed him on if Navalny would ever walk out of a Russian prison.
Will you commit that you will personally ensure that Alexei Navalny will leave prison alive?
I proceed from the premise that the person that you have mentioned, the same kind of measures will apply, not in any way worse than to anybody else who happens to be in prison.
His name is Alexei Navalny. People will note that you were
I don't care.
To say
I don't
that
care.
He would leave prison alive. Alexei Navalny's wife has accused the authorities of hiding her husband's body. The Kremlin says an investigation is ongoing into his death, but there are no results yet. Ellison?
Keir Simmons, thank you. For more on the fallout from Alexei Navalny's death in Russia and beyond, I'm joined now by former United States Ambassador to Russia and NBC News International Affairs Analyst Michael McFaul. Ambassador McFaul, thank you so much for joining us tonight. So let's just start with what we've heard from Navalny's wife, Yulia. She has accused Russian authorities of refusing to release his body to his mother. Authorities there have reportedly told the family they need to do some sort of chemical test that will take about 14 days. Navalny's family says this is a farce, and Russian officials, in their view, are trying to hide the fact that Navalny was poisoned by Putin. What do you make of those claims, and is there any way an outside group could force Russian officials to release Navalny's body to some third party, a non-governmental organization like the Red Cross, for instance, so they could oversee an autopsy?
Well, to your first question, I don't think there's any reason not to believe what Yulia Navalny has said and her supporters. This is extremely strange. This is odd, 14 days. It sure sounds like they're trying to get rid of the poison that killed Alexei Navalny. And I want to be clear about this. No matter what we finally learn, let's be crystal clear. Putin killed Navalny. He tried to kill him before. When he left Germany and then came back, he arrested him. He's been torturing him for 3 years, gradually getting worse and worse conditions where he was held in prison. And so what the final straw was that killed him in some ways is immaterial. Putin killed Navalny. In answer to your second question, it's an interesting idea. I know people are talking about it. I'm not optimistic knowing Putin's Russia, the way they operate. I don't see any reason why they would allow that to happen. But calling for it at least keeps the focus on what's going on or not going on, and I think that's a good in and of itself.
Is there more that the United States could or should be doing in this situation?
Well, in the immediate, showing support for Yulia, is showing support for her family. I thought the president made a very strong statement the other night. Vice President Harris met with Yulia Navalny in the Munich Security Conference. That's important symbolically. But now I think it is time for action. And remember, the Ukrainians are fighting the same guy. Ukrainians are dying at Putin's hand every single day as well. And so it's hard to think about, you know, helping democracy in Russia. That's a big, tall order that will go on, I think, for years. Although there's much more we should be doing on that in terms of providing real information, real reporting to Russians. That's cut off. We could do that in the long run. But in the short run, it's really easy what we should do. We should pass the new aid bill to Ukraine. That $60 billion, it would be a very direct way to help the Ukrainians that are fighting Putin's invaders. It doesn't have to be abstract. It's not some long-term thing. It's literally on the desk of members of Congress, and Speaker Johnson should do that, because every day that they delay, that is a gift to Putin. This does not seem to me like a time in history when you should be giving gifts to Vladimir Putin.
Yeah, I mean, you look at just the last year, give or take, and what's been happening with Putin. The International Criminal Court, the ICC, they've already issued an arrest warrant for him related to alleged war crimes and the forcible deportation of children from Ukraine. You have Americans like Paul Whelan and Wall Street Journal reporter Evan Gershkovitz still in Russian prisons despite U.S. condemnation of their detention. The U.S. and the EU, they heavily sanctioned Russia and Putin because of the war in Ukraine. His life, his hold on power, it really doesn't seem like it's changed. Is Putin untouchable outside of military action?
Well, there are things we could do on all the fronts that you just described to tighten things, particularly on sanctions. There's all kinds of things one could do. For instance, we have frozen $300 billion of Russian government assets, mostly in Europe, but we have some in the United States and other countries. I think it is time to give those assets to the Ukrainians for their reconstruction and economic assistance. Another very concrete thing could happen overnight. Lots of political support for it in the United States. They could do that. But the most important thing is to defeat Putin on the battleground. There's nothing that will threaten his power inside Russia than losing on the battlefield. And that's very concrete. It doesn't have to be abstract, a very concrete thing that could happen. And Russian opposition leaders, including Yulia and others, as well as Ukrainians, they share this common enemy, Vladimir Putin. That is the way to bring about pressure on him right away.
When you look at what's happening inside of Russia in terms of Russian citizens who are being arrested at times, certainly risking arrest by protesting and also attending memorials for Navalny, what do you make of all of that? I mean, does it tell us anything right now about the sentiment amongst the Russian population?
I'd say a couple of things. First of all, those are very brave people who are being arrested. They could suffer really dire consequences. Other people have gotten many, many years in jail just for saying the word war. So remember what kind of totalitarian dictatorship Putin leads today. And yet, the fact that they're there, I think, is also a source of optimism. They are doing, I think, what millions of Russians would want to do, but just don't have the bravery to do it. And think about it. If Putin was so strong and everybody loved him so much, why did he have to kill Navalny? Why did he have to kill Alexei Navalny? That, to me, is a move of weakness, not of strength. And I think that's the right way to interpret these demonstrations as well.
All right. Ambassador Mike McFaul, thank you so much. We appreciate your time and insights. Thank you.
Sure. Thanks for having me.
And the news of Navalny's death also impacting American politics. Former President Trump breaking his silence about the opposition leader's death, but not condemning Russian President Putin. NBC News senior Capitol Hill correspondent Garrett Hake with what President Biden is contemplating.
3 years ago, President Biden warned Putin of devastating consequences if Alexei Navalny died in Russian custody. Tonight, Mr. Biden says he's weighing new sanctions.
We already have sanctions moving and we're considering additional sanctions, yes.
Tonight, Republican frontrunner Donald Trump's first comment on Navalny, making no mention of Putin or Russia. Writing, the sudden death of Alexei Navalny has made me more and more aware of what is happening in our country. Nikki Haley slamming that comment and Trump's recent remarks that he would encourage Russia to attack NATO allies unwilling to meet defense spending goals.
He sided with a dictator who kills his political opponents.
The Biden campaign also looking to exploit those comments.
Every president since Truman has been a rock-solid supporter of NATO.
Targeting this digital ad to the 900,000 Michigan voters with roots in NATO border states. Voters like Andy Ladek, a U.S. Army veteran who immigrated from Poland as a child and finds the remarks disqualifying for a would-be commander-in-chief.
For someone like a former president of the United States to say something like that is beyond the pale. It's just totally unacceptable.
But President Biden faces an uphill battle here in Michigan, where polls show Mr. Trump in a strong position.
Garrett joins us now from Troy, Michigan. So, Garrett, we know former President Trump has also been critical of sending aid to Ukraine. Could the death of Navalny put pressure on Congress to pass that stalled aid package for Ukraine?
I think that's unlikely, Ellison, unless and until Donald Trump changes his tune about either Navalny or the aid package. For now, I think it's going to take some other bigger political change to affect House Republicans' commitment on Ukraine, possibly attaching that aid to government funding or some other must-pass bill. Right now, Congress is out the rest of the week, and that aid package is going nowhere fast. Ellison?
Garrett Hake, thank you. For more on Donald Trump and the state of the 2024 race, let's bring in Garrett Ventry, the founder of GRV Strategies and Message Impact and former GOP communications advisor. Garrett, thank you for joining us tonight. I want to ask you more about Trump's comments, where Garrett was just reporting there, as it relates to Alexei Navalny and comparing it some in many ways to his own legal woes. Do you think Trump not condemning Putin impacts voters and any sort of concerns they may have?
Hey, thanks for having me. I really appreciate it. I think if you take a step back on this, there certainly could be, you know, comments made here. And I think the president will address this here in the next coming days. So I'm sure it'll be asked about on the campaign trail. But again, if you take a step back here and you look at President Trump's record when it comes to Russia, you're talking about he sanctioned Putin multiple times during his administration. And the two times that Putin has invaded Ukraine was once under President Obama and now another time under President Biden. So I think that there is some weakness on the world stage that President Biden has portrayed. You've seen this, whether it's with, you know, the attack on Israel from Hamas. You've seen this with Afghanistan falling to the Taliban here. So the foreign policy question we're seeing here is not about rhetoric, but action here. And President Trump is one of the strongest presidents we've had on Russia. And so I think impacting that, voters will have to take a look at that going, obviously, into 2024.
You mentioned his record with Russia. Let's talk a little more about that, because I want to show some video from 2018. Putin and Trump met at a summit in Helsinki, Finland. I was a reporter covering it at the time. They met for hours. And then while standing next to Putin at a press conference, Trump said he believed Putin and Russia on allegations of election interference, not the U.S. intelligence agencies then President Trump oversaw. Trump was roundly criticized for this at the time. Even the Republican House Speaker released a statement condemning Trump for his comments in this summit. If Trump is not willing to criticize Russia in this moment, does that in some ways leave a door open to prove those critics in 2018 right? And I know you mentioned some of his record, but if they look at that and they point to this moment and then that big moment on a massive viewing global stage to say Donald Trump is soft on Vladimir Putin, do they have strong evidence for it?
They don't have strong evidence on that. Again, you're looking at here, you're talking about sanctions and the world and our NATO allies. Ukraine as well, we're more safe when President Trump was the president. You're talking about right now, it is Joe Biden who's the president when this is happening here. This death of obviously his leading opposition in prison is obviously very concerning here. And I hope that we do get to the bottom, but it's probably obviously Putin who did this. Putin is someone who is a thug, someone who should be condemned here. And you're talking about President Trump, though, does have a very, very strong record when you're coming to Russia. Again, the sanctions, and you're talking about the world and our NATO allies, including Ukraine, who's obviously not part of NATO, were safer when President Trump was in office.
Is it a problem, though, for Trump as a candidate, politically speaking, when you have someone like Tim Scott, right, his former rival turned very important surrogate who was on CNN? I actually think we have a clip of it that we can play for you. This is what he had to say on CNN.
The murderous dictator that is President Putin always looks for ways to take out the competition. We need strong leadership coming from America that actually pushes back against Russia and other dictators. Unfortunately, Joe Biden is not up for that charge, and Donald Trump is.
Is it a good look politically to have a high-profile surrogate take verbally a tougher stance on Putin, particularly when that surrogate is a South Carolina senator and you have the South Carolina primary in less than a week? What would you be advising Trump to do in terms of what he's saying about this right now?
I think President Trump should just point to his record here. Again, we're talking about President Biden and others can talk and have rhetoric on this here, but you're talking about action. Again, the sanctions he did, he sanctioned multiple Russian officials. And it goes back to just the stats here. You're talking about Obama again. It was Crimea was invaded and annexed under Obama. Under Biden, you had Russia invade Ukraine, a continued two-year bloodshed war there, which is, you know, cost to U.S. billions of dollars, obviously.
But Donald, Donald Trump isn't saying any of that right now on the campaign trail. Do you think he should be pointing that out? I mean, are you content with the statement he has given thus far?
I'm sure he will point that out again here, and voters will know his record going into 2024. The world was a safer place under Donald Trump. You can just look at the facts. There were no new wars. He obliterated ISIS. Putin was not invading Ukraine under Donald Trump. He was doing it under Joe Biden because he senses weakness from Joe Biden on the world stage.
Let's talk a little bit about Nikki Haley here, especially as we get so close to that primary in South Carolina. She's now come out multiple times criticizing Trump's comments on both NATO and Navalny. And she's also issued arguably some of her strongest attacks on the legal woes as it relates to the former president. Give us a realistic gut check here. What do you think her future in this race looks like after South Carolina? Is there any chance the polls are wrong and she maybe tightens the gap in South Carolina? If she loses, do you think she drops out?
Yeah, it's a great question here. And I mean, she just can't pick. She's been asked this on the campaign trail multiple times. What state can she win? She can't point to one. She said, you know, she was going to perform well in New Hampshire. She lost to President Trump by double digits. She got destroyed by 35 points in Iowa, I believe. And you're talking about South Carolina here. You're looking at the polling. Trump's up 30 points there. She can't, again, point to a state that she's going to win here. And so I just don't know what her path forward is here. Donald Trump has dominated this race. I think everybody can see this here. He's going to be the nominee. I think there's a just as good a chance of Dean Phillips being the Democrat nominee as there is for Nikki Haley being the Republican nominee. It's not going to happen. Trump has a stranglehold on the Republican Party here. He's leading in all the polls going forward against Nikki Haley, and matches up very strongly in your NBC poll against Joe Biden. Your recent one shows him up 47-42, and he's beating Joe Biden on the issues that matter to voters the most: immigration, the economy, inflation, and national security. And even with all this Russia talk here, you're talking about he has a strong lead on national security and handling of foreign policy over the last year in every single poll that you can think of today.
All right, a lot to watch this week. Again, the South Carolina primary, not even a week away. Garrett Ventry, thank you so much. We appreciate it. Next tonight, moving overseas. The IDF saying it has struck Hezbollah storage facilities in Lebanon. You can see here what appears to be the huge explosions from those Israeli strikes. The IDF says it targeted the area after a drone it believes came from Lebanon was launched in the direction towards Israel. NBC News foreign correspondent Raf Sanchez joins us now with more. So, Raf, what do we know about these strikes as of right now?
So, Ellison, these strikes took place just outside the Lebanese city of Sidon. It's about halfway up the coast of Lebanon, which is significant because that is further inland than most Israeli strikes so far since October 7th. Those have been tended to focus further down towards the Israel-Lebanon border, where a lot of Hezbollah's firepower is concentrated. As you said, Israel says it was responding to an armed drone that flew over the border earlier in the day. It says it hit two Hezbollah weapons depots, and you can see just the scale of those explosions. Lebanese state media is saying these were, in fact, commercial factories. They are saying at least 14 people were injured and that most of them are Syrian and Palestinian workers. Elsa.
Yeah, so, Raf, I mean, as you said, there have been these strikes across the Israel-Lebanon border between the IDF and Hezbollah really since the early days of the war in Gaza. But when you see a strike like this that goes so much deeper into another country's territory, it could change things, right? I mean, do we expect Hezbollah to respond in a bigger way here?
Yeah, Allison, it's a really good question. Hezbollah has a kind of complicated internal calculus when it decides how to respond. On the one hand, for its own sense of self as a group that resists Israel, it will feel that it needs to respond. On the other hand, we have seen it be pretty careful throughout the war, not attacking Israel at such a scale that it would provoke a full-scale war, at least not yet. Remember, the economy in Lebanon is absolutely devastated. Hezbollah does have its own domestic constituency, but most Lebanese do not want to see a full-scale war with Israel at this point. The leader of Hezbollah has said Israel will, quote, pay in blood for the deaths of civilians inside of Lebanon. It doesn't look at this point like civilians were killed. It is worth noting, Israel carried out that drone strike which killed a senior leader of Hamas, and that happened in the suburbs of Beirut, the Lebanese capital. And even though that strike took place in such a sensitive location, Hezbollah's response was actually fairly restrained. Elsa.
Raf Sanchez, thank you. Staying now with the escalating tensions in the Middle East. Over the weekend, the U.S. launching 5 attacks against Houthi targets in Yemen, one of those strikes destroying an underwater drone. Houthi forces firing back, attacking a British cargo ship in the Red Sea. All of this, as the Pentagon says they're investigating a crash involving a U.S. military drone off the coast of Yemen. NBC News Pentagon correspondent Courtney Kuby joins us now. So, Courtney, walk us through what we know about these latest attacks as of now.
It's been a really dynamic environment, Ellison. So on that underwater drone that you mentioned, that's the first time the Houthis have done anything like that. We have seen them launch surface vessels, so sea drones that skim along the top of the water, and the U.S. has been able to take some of those out. But it's the first time that they, as far as the U.S. knows, they've actually used one that's gone underwater, essentially a submarine drone. But we are learning a little bit more. You mentioned that there was an MQ-9 Reaper drone that crashed today near the port city of Hodeidah in Yemen. Yemen. The Houthis are claiming they shot that down with a missile. They've even released some video that they claim shows the drone being shot down and some of the wreckage washing up along the shore. But the U.S. military says they are still investigating what brought that drone down. It wouldn't be the first time Houthis have actually taken out a U.S. drone in recent months. Now, there have also been a number of commercial vessels that have been targeted. There was the British flagged ship, the British owned ship that was shot with an anti-ship ballistic missile on Sunday, disabling the ship. The crew actually abandoned the vessel, and there's at least one coalition military ship that's still there on scene. But in addition to that, Ellison, we are just learning details this evening about two U.S. owned ships, both commercial ships, that were targeted, one by an anti-ship ballistic missile that fell short of the ship, but another one by a drone that also fell short of the ship, but the impact on the water caused some minor damage. Both of the ships were able to move along, but as you mentioned, a real escalation of the tensions in the region as these Houthi attacks continue. We've also learned the U.S. has carried out several dynamic or self-defense strikes again. So both sides continuing their back and forth, Ellison.
So Courtney, what will you be watching for in the next 24 hours? When you talk to your sources there at the Pentagon, is there any indication that those strikes they've already started to carry out, they could do even more of those dynamic strikes in the next 24 or 48 hours?
Yes, absolutely. We should expect to see those sorts of dynamic strikes really every single day. Every time the Houthis pop up a mobile missile launcher or a drone launcher, the U.S. is moving in and they are taking them out. And that's because the authorities have changed. Now the authority to carry out those strikes is at the U.S. military, the uniform military level, so they happen very quickly. But I think the big question we should all be watching for is, will there be more of the larger retaliatory strikes? Those are the ones we saw a couple of weeks ago, first in Iraq and Syria, and then next in Yemen. We have been told by a number of U.S. officials that those are supposed to be carried out over a matter of weeks, maybe in waves. So the reality is we could see more of those larger retaliatory strikes in coming days, Ellison.
Courtney Kuby outside of the Pentagon. Still ahead tonight, missing in Spain, a Florida woman vanishing from a Madrid apartment amid a messy divorce back home. The text message her friend received a day after she disappeared. Plus, the officer racing to pull a six-month-old baby from the wreckage of a car crash, how he helped save the infant's life before paramedics arrived. Back now with a harrowing rescue of a six-month-old child from a deadly car crash. A Florida police officer pulling the pulseless infant from a wrecked vehicle after a motorcyclist flying down the highway at more than 100 miles per hour slammed through its side window. The miraculous moment that child was resuscitated. NBC News correspondent Marissa Parra has this story and a warning. Some of what you see and hear may be distressing.
Oh, man.
In those first moments after a crash on the highway,
I need you to hold this little girl, please.
Every second could mean the difference between life and death.
Is your baby okay?
No! Officer Dave Musgrove knew this mother and her two girls needed all the help they could get.
Hey, sir, can you try to help us?
Yeah.
All right.
My baby, I need my baby.
Officer Musgrove had been driving down a highway near Englewood, Florida, when a motorcycle sped past him at over 100 miles per hour. This bright flash from his dashcam video capturing the collision that would take the motorcyclist's life and almost claimed more.
Hey, sweetheart, come here. Come here, sweetheart.
Musgrove pulling three-year-old Ariel from the wreckage, flagging down a nearby driver for help, going back to the mangled car for the mom and her baby. But six-month-old Lola wasn't moving.
Seeing the EMS.
Oh, my baby! Is she dead? Is she dead?
Musgrove, thinking fast, began chest compressions.
I just heard her breathe. You got it? Come on.
The EMTs who arrived shortly after confirming a tiny heartbeat. Mom wouldn't have to say another goodbye.
She actually was born 2 days after I lost my fiance. So my daughters mean a lot to me, but she means a lot to me as well. And I just couldn't lose her.
A love only a parent could understand.
I'm a father. I'm caring. I mean, we're all cops. We all care. So she's innocent. She didn't deserve this.
Baby Lola has a long recovery ahead at the hospital, but her family grateful for her second chance at life.
He's our hero.
He is. You know, we will never repay him for what he did, because what he did for us was life-changing.
Marissa Parra, NBC News.
Next to the international search for an American woman who disappeared in Madrid amid a separation from her husband that her friends describe as messy. The last communication from the 40-year-old was a series of strange texts she sent to a friend. Now tonight, a lawyer for her husband tells us his client was in another country when she went missing and insists the separation was amicable. NBC News correspondent Stephen Romo with the late details.
Someone has done something to her, and I'm trying to understand who it could be and why.
Tonight, friends and family of 40-year-old Anna Maria Nesevich are desperate to know where she is. The Florida resident was last seen on February 2nd at an apartment she was renting in Madrid.
She is just so caring. She is so sweet. She is just so soft. She is funny. She is smart. She's adventurous.
Nesevich moved to Spain in December amid a difficult separation from her husband, David, according to her friend, Sana Rameau, who says she texted Nesevich the day she was last seen, but didn't hear back. But the next day, she got what she called strange messages saying, I met someone wonderful. He has a summer house about 2 hours from Madrid. I will spend a few days there. Signal is spotty. Adding, he approached me on the street. Amazing connection.
I tried to respond saying that I got worried about her. Like, it didn't sound safe. Like, what is she talking about? Like, this makes no sense. And my messages didn't go through.
A las ocho y media de la noche estaba en su casa.
Joaquin Emils Bonet is president of an entirely volunteer-run missing persons organization in Spain and acting as a spokesperson for the family. He says that at 8:30 p.m. on February 2nd, Nesevich spoke on the phone with a friend for about an hour and didn't have plans to go out. At about 1 a.m., a neighbor across the street saw lights on in her apartment. Emils Bonet says that at some point on February 2nd, a neighbor saw that the security cameras in her building had been painted black.
Por lo tanto,
Emils Bonet warns not to jump to conclusions, saying, we don't know the time the cameras were painted, and we also don't know if it was just a random act of vandalism. But friends of Nesevich are quick to bring up the couple's contentious separation, specifically the joint financial interests. NBC News found three corporations registered under the couple's names in Florida. EOX Technology Solutions Incorporated, Registered Corporate Agents, LLC, and EOX Capital, LLC. Nesevich's brother telling the Fort Lauderdale police her husband, David, is, quote, not happy about the amount of money that needs to be split. Ken Padowitz, a defense attorney hired by David Nesevich, telling us the divorce proceedings hadn't officially started and that his client is cooperating with authorities.
We obviously hope, like everyone else, that she's found and she's okay. But David has nothing to do with this. He was in another country at the time that she disappeared in Spain.
Just to be clear, he's been in Serbia that entire span of time since before February?
Correct. He's been in Serbia prior to his wife ever gone missing in Spain.
And Stephen Romo joins us now. Stephen, this is a complicated case with so many questions still, but has the State Department weighed in at all?
Yeah, the State Department did answer us today saying that they're involved in any missing persons case involving an American who's lost abroad. They didn't give us any specific information about this case. But that missing persons organization we spoke to in the piece, they did tell us this story is all over the media in Spain, but getting information from police in Madrid has been difficult. He says they've just not been very forthcoming. So there are so many questions left in this case, Allison.
All right, Stephen Romo, thank you for bringing us that. When we come back, the late night legal battle, why former Congressman George Santos is now suing Jimmy Kimmel over a segment on his nightly show. The details up next. Back now with Top Stories News Feed, and we begin with a deadly shooting at an Indianapolis Waffle House. Authorities say they arrived at the scene and found five people with gunshot wounds, one woman later dying at the hospital. The remaining victims are expected to be okay. Police believe the incident started with a disagreement between two groups and say they're investigating whether any of those injured also fired shots. An update in the case of an 11-year-old in Texas who's been missing for 4 days now. Officials say they've identified a person of interest, 42-year-old Don Stephen McDougal, who is currently in police custody for unrelated charges. Audrey Cunningham was supposed to catch a school bus in her hometown of Livingston Thursday morning,
but never made it, according to her family. Investigators and search volunteers have been combing the area since then, but no signs of her just yet. And former Congressman George Santos launching a legal battle against late-night TV host Jimmy Kimmel. The lawsuit is linked to a segment on Jimmy Kimmel Live called Will Santos Say It?, in which Kimmel pranked Santos with fake requests on Cameo, a site where celebrities sell personalized video messages. Santos alleges Kimmel and his producers committed copyright infringement, fraud, breach of contract, and unjust enrichment by making the request and then broadcasting the videos. Santos had previously sent Kimmel a cease and desist letter. In Minnesota tonight, a community is mourning the death of two police officers and a paramedic killed in the line of duty. The three men were shot and killed while responding to a domestic violence call early yesterday morning. NBC News correspondent Adrian Bradas has more.
Outside the Burnsville, Minnesota police station, balloons, flowers, and embraces as this community mourns the three first responders killed early Sunday.
They put their lives on the line every day for us. Everybody is hurting right now.
Police officers Paul Elmstrand, Matthew Ruge, both 27, and 40-year-old firefighter paramedic Adam Finseth were shot while responding to a domestic violence incident.
We are all hurting. We're heartbroken. We are heartbroken.
Tonight, the county medical examiner confirming the man responsible for their deaths is 38-year-old Shannon Cortez Gooden. Police say it began at 1:50 Sunday morning with the 911 call reporting a man was armed and barricaded inside a home. Officers arrived and began negotiating with him, later learning there were seven children inside, ages 2 to 15. Around 5 a.m., neighbors say they heard shots. Police say the gunman fired from both floors of the home.
Medics, please back off. Medics, back off and turn off lights.
By 8 a.m., the shooter was dead. Others inside were able to get out safely. Court documents show Gooden was prohibited from possessing firearms following a 2008 conviction. In 2020, he petitioned to have his access to guns restored. That was denied. Tonight, Burnsville remembering Elmstrand, a 6.5-year veteran of the department, Ruge, who was part of the crisis negotiation team, and Finseth, a SWAT paramedic.
Every day, we pray that they go home to their families. And today, that's not happening.
And for the heartbroken, we've seen a lot of hugs outside of this memorial throughout the day. That's part of the healing process. And another officer who was also injured in the shooting is out of the hospital home and expected to fully recover. Ellison.
Adrian Bradas, thank you. Coming up, the March for Democracy in Mexico. Hundreds of thousands of demonstrators taking to the streets in Mexico City. Why they're worried the current president is trying to weaken the country's election process during his last few months in office. We're back now with top stories, Global Watch, and the massacre in Papua New Guinea amid an increasing tribal conflict. Officials say at least 26 people were killed in an armed conflict between warring tribes in the highland region. Papua New Guinea's government is warning of more violence as they battle limited police resources. Australia's prime minister has vowed to help and assist its neighboring country to try and stop some of the violence. Parts of Bolivia on high alert as torrential rain has triggered deadly mudslides. New video shows residents in La Paz attempting to grab belongings from collapsed buildings after record-breaking torrential rainfall triggered floods and landslides in the region. Local media reporting three dead, among them two children. Dozens of families have also been displaced. And the famed Eiffel Tower shut down to visitors as its staff goes on strike. Workers at the landmark protesting for higher wages and better management of the site's maintenance. The tower is usually open 365 days a year. It's expected to remain closed tomorrow. But right now, it's unclear how long this strike will last. And now to the Americas, where thousands of protesters marched throughout the city streets in Mexico, many criticizing the country's current administration for attempting to make changes in election laws ahead of the presidential election in June. NBC News correspondent Guad Venegas has the latest.
Democracia! Massive crowds flooding the streets in Mexico City. Protesters joining what organizers called the March for Democracy in response to proposed changes backed by President Andrés Manuel López Obrador that could impact the country's future elections, changes some critics are calling unconstitutional. The protesters also expressing anger against the current administration after criminal violence left more than 30,000 dead for a sixth year in a row in 2023.
El gobierno actual nos está llevando a la catástrofe. Nos está llevando a estar cada vez peor, a estar temerosos, a no querer salir a la calle porque tenemos miedo.
Organizers say nearly 700,000 demonstrators marched to the Capitol Central Square over the weekend, forming a sea of pink, demanding the National Elections Agency to remain unchanged. The former president of the National Electoral Institute telling protesters some institutions of democracy, such as the Supreme Court and the Institute itself, are at risk. Last year, the country's president proposed drastic changes to the Electoral Institute, which would cut its budget, staff, and would close offices.
Vengo porque creo en un gobierno de instituciones.
Me preocupa el crimen organizado metiéndose a las elecciones y que nuestro país pierda el rumbo.
Lo más complicado es.
But President López Obrador pushing back at a press conference today.
Estos corruptos, los que ayer se movilizaron en contra de la transformación, quieren pararnos. No han podido, no van a poder.
The protests come in the final months of López Obrador's term as president. The two leading candidates to succeed him are former Mexico City Mayor Claudia Sheinbaum from Obrador's party and endorsed by the president, and opposition candidate Xochitl Galvez, a former senator.
Quiero celebrar.
Galvez praising the demonstrators on social media, saying it filled her with hope and optimism to see the large participation by the people who attended. But the most important opportunity for those who disagree will come in less than 4 months when Mexico holds its upcoming presidential elections.
And NBC News correspondent Guad Venegas joins us now. Guad, there has also been a lot of talk about AMLO spending too much state money and perhaps making it difficult for his replacement to come in and change things. What should people know about that?
Ellison, well, AMLO has spent a lot of state money on these large projects like a large new airport, a new refinery, as well as a new Mexican government-run airline and a train system. Now, the next president would have to continue with all of these projects in order for the government to see a return on their investment and for the projects to be completed and successful. Otherwise, they're just going to become unsuccessful, unfinished projects launched by this Mexican populist president. Ellison.
Guad Venegas, thank you. Thank you so much for watching Top Story. I'm Ellison Barber in for Tom Llamas in New York. Stay right there. More news now is on the way.
Thanks for watching. Stay updated about breaking news and top stories on the NBC News app or follow us on social media.